Hi, I'm Jenny Brocky. Australia is one of the allergy capitals of the world. Tonight on Insight, fixing allergies. Welcome, everybody. Good to have you with us tonight. Anne-Marie, you were recently at a function in Melbourne. I think you just started eating the entree. What happened?
I had just started eating the entree, Jenny, which was goat's cheese. And once I'd consumed it, my lips started to swell, as did my tongue, and that all happened in about 20 seconds. So considering I was also involved with the function, that made things a little difficult.
Oh, so you were organising the function as well.
As well as. And so one of my work colleagues, her husband was at the function, and he had one look and just thought, I've got to get you to hospital, which was really, well, that was good in the sense that it was really close to St Vincent's.
And we've got a picture of you here.
Lovely.
Which doesn't look like you now, I hasten to add. How bad was it?
Three adrenaline shots. So the anaphylaxis was evident immediately. And I've got that eczema, asthma background. So, of course, it was difficult to breathe and,
You're 59. Have you ever had that kind of reaction before?
No.
Have you had food allergies before?
Had the odd food allergy, but I had started using some goat's moisturising lotion, naturally thinking it was a product that would be good for my skin. And I'd been using that sort of through the year. And then one of the days I put it on, my arms just went bright red and the heat was just amazing. So I obviously stopped using that.
Did you have eczema or anything when you were using
No.
it? Were you using it for anything like
No,
that?
Just, No, just for, as a moisturiser.
Okay. Had you had goat's cheese before?
Well, I believe so, but, you know, I can't really remember. I certainly didn't have an allergic reaction like that.
Hmm. Robin, how can a moisturiser cause a food allergy?
Well, the clue was in what Anne-Marie was saying. A lot of these natural products do have food allergens in them, such as the goat milk. And intact skin is a beautiful barrier to the immune system. It stops bacteria and foreign allergens getting into the into the body. But when you have eczema, it can activate the immune system and sensitise the system, as it did in her case.
So does it have to be a food-based product to create that food-based allergy?
To cause
allergy?
This sort of subsequent food anaphylaxis when she ate the food, yes.
But I've seen food substances in lots of products
exactly.
that you put on your skin.
Exactly.
Is that potentially a problem for anyone who's allergy prone?
It's potentially a problem for people with allergy and eczema. So it's the inflamed and damaged skin. So if you have normal skin, it's not a problem.
Have you seen it with other products?
We have. We've seen it with other patients with different goat preparations and also patients with some of the oat preparations.
Mm, fascinating. I think a lot of people probably wouldn't realise all of this.
Well, I think that's right. I mean, the point is with eczema anyway, moisturiser is meant to be applied to the normal skin. And then the prescription ointments are applied to the damaged skin. But you can imagine when you do have a tendency to eczema, people just put it all over their skin or they hop in a bath wash and don't realise, in fact, that there is a risk. Hmm.
What happened to the goat's milk moisturiser?
Gone.
Gone skin.
Gone.
Mm. Okay. Katie, how common are food allergies in Australia at the moment?
Well, unfortunately, Australia seems to be the food allergy capital. And certainly we've found in our own study in Melbourne of 5,300 kids that 1 in 10 infants had challenge-proven food allergy.
1 in 10?
So that's in Melbourne in one study. But we think it's somewhere between 5 and 10% across all ages. So it's much less common in adults. And it's certainly more common in infants and children.
Has it stabilised or is it rising, do you think?
Well, it's been described as the new epidemic. As allergists, we don't like to use the word epidemic. That's sort of more to do with infectious diseases. But in fact, we think it wasn't around 30 years ago and it's certainly around now. So we think it has risen. We don't know whether it's continuing to rise or whether it's plateaued. We just don't know the answer at the moment.
Mm. And do we know why?
Well, that is the $64 million question. We're pretty hot on the hill with what we think might be some of the key factors. We think it's something to do with modern lifestyle.
The modern lifestyle is a very broad area of the home. It doesn't narrow it down.
I think
does
the thing is that in the past, in some ways, allergies had a bit of a bad name because we keep changing our views on what advice to give people. Okay. And so we're trying to come up with something that's, you know, going to be robust with regards to outcomes.
Richard, are people becoming more allergic to more types of food?
You can be allergic to almost any food. So we've seen patients who anaphylax to watermelon, to kiwi fruit. So it's not just peanut, tree nuts, fish, shellfish, cow's milk, egg. So there are unusual foods like cinnamon, spices can cause anaphylaxis.
Lots of people have allergies, but what is the difference between an allergy and an intolerance? Because people use the word allergy very loosely. Can you describe the difference?
When allergists talk about a true allergy, we often talk about IgE-mediated. That means there's a protein in the blood called IgE, and this protein, when it binds onto certain cells in the body, releases chemicals and cause an allergic reaction. I'm Asian, and many Asians are lactose intolerant. I lack an enzyme that breaks down a sugar that you have in food, and I have tummy upsets with it, but that's more an intolerance. And there are many other things that you can be intolerant to.
An allergy affects the immune system, though. It's an immune system
issue. It's immune
issue,
response. Yeah.
Whereas an intolerance isn't. Is that right?
Yes. In most cases, it isn't involving the immune system.
So an allergy can be life-threatening, but an intolerance isn't. Is that the bottom line with this?
Well, allergies that are IgE can cause anaphylaxis. Allergies that are non-IgE can't cause anaphylaxis.
And how is anyone to know that?
Well, it's easy. Skin prick test or a blood test. It's so simple. In fact, that's the one thing about allergy diagnosis is we really know how to diagnose IgE-mediated food allergy. We know that.
Can some of the reactions be similar, though, between intolerances and allergies?
No, actually, the reality is IgE-mediated food allergy is quite distinctive. And the children or the adult comes in and they've had an allergic reaction, which the parents can identify. You know, the child has just eaten their first bite of a peanut butter sandwich. They blow up like Michelin Man, you know, have swollen lips and swollen face, and they may vomit, they may have hives, and they might start to cough and wheeze, and they've got anaphylaxis. It's happened within a few minutes. The intolerances are quite different presentation.
Anne-Marie, have you become sensitive to anything else?
Yes, seafood.
So you didn't have that before?
No.
So that happened at the same time, the same time?
No, about 3 months later.
Okay. Mm. All seafood or just crustaceans?
All seafood.
Wow, that's a big one.
Except for all tuna in a can. I can eat that.
You can eat tuna in a can. Okay. Great.
Yes.
Sam, your four-year-old has a range of anaphylactic allergies. How severe are his reactions if he eats certain foods?
He's had a number of anaphylactic episodes where it's an immediate respiratory response. Unfortunately, he doesn't always swell up or puff up.
So you can't see it in terms of that.
Yeah, and every time he's had an anaphylactic episode, it's had a different presentation, but if he swelled every time, it would almost be a little bit easier.
How did you find out that he had this?
So he had chronic eczema at 4 months. At 6 months, we had a skin prick test done that revealed he had an egg allergy. At 9 months, I'd cooked some roast carrots with a little bit of maple syrup and a tiny bit of mustard. I took one carrot out and mixed it with his, and he ate the carrot and had anaphylaxis. So he's anaphylactic to mustard seed. Then we had skin prick testing done again at 12 months, which revealed the peanut allergy.
And your second child's 6 months old.
Yep.
So what sort of advice have you been given regarding the two children around this? Have you got a family history?
My husband and I both had childhood asthma and hay fever. And my husband may have had a little bit of eczema. So we were going to be more prone to this. We didn't know this until after we'd had our son, though.
So what advice were you given with the first child?
And well, then because we didn't get any particular advice. So I ate peanuts. I ate everything apart from the foods that most pregnant women don't eat. Didn't drink any alcohol at all. And I definitely ate peanuts and other nuts, eggs. I ate a lot of eggs towards the end of my pregnancy when I was baking a lot.
What about the second child, though? What advice were you given about the second child?
So vitamin D supplement during pregnancy, definitely include eggs and nuts in my diet. That said, there was a soft recommendation around avoiding peanuts. And I was also told to breastfeed with my first son and with my second son as long as I could. So I breastfed my four-year-old until he was 16 months.
And your second child is now 6 months old? Any signs of allergies?
Yeah. So he had, we think it's an allergic reaction to Keflex. They thought he may have had some infected eczema on his face and we were
prescribed. Which is an antibiotic?
Yeah. But like a moderate allergic reaction. So that was treated with steroid. And he has a non-IgE mediated dairy allergy, but we think that he's probably outgrown that now. And he's also had an allergic reaction to avocado. But it wasn't anaphylaxis, it was, I guess, a moderate allergic reaction.
Richard, what is the current advice to pregnant women and to parents about small babies and toddlers and so on in terms of what to do?
The current advice during pregnancy and breastfeeding is just to have a normal diet.
Now, that's the opposite of what the advice was how long ago?
Probably 5-6 years ago.
OK, so the advice has come right around the other way. And why has it changed, Katie?
Well, it's changed based on evidence. And the evidence is that the delaying the introduction of allergenic solids, so egg and peanut and cow's milk, doesn't protect you from allergy. So the idea is that early introduction may protect you from allergy. So it's changed based on research.
And how can you be 100% sure then that the advice you're giving now is the right advice?
You can't. And the problem with Google is you can go on many, many sites and actually not know what's current.
So what to feed small babies?
You can just feed children as you do for any other normal child, one food at a time, small amounts, increasing those small amounts, and that's a safe way to introduce solids into an infant's diet.
And if you've got a family history...
Same advice? Yes,
okay.
There are no specific allergy-related advice now.
Robert, you've decided pretty much to ignore the current advice. You're still suggesting pregnant women be careful about their exposure to certain foods. Why?
Well, I think the first thing to say is that there's a difference between advice that you give to people in the general population and people who have a history of allergies in the general population. I don't think the pregnancy is a big issue, but I think what happens after pregnancy when the baby's born is important. And so we encourage people to, particularly with the nuts, to eliminate all the nuts out of the household. And not
this is
just
for people with a history?
Where there's already one allergic child in the family. It's not just what the mother's eating or isn't eating, it's what the whole family's eating. So we've been giving people that advice for a long time now and looking at the outcomes down the track. We've been following kids now for 10 years and there's a dramatic drop in the incidence of new allergies in people who took that advice compared with those who didn't.
So you're talking, you know, avoidance, really.
But I'm only talking about it for high-risk people already an allergic child in the family.
OK. Can I throw this open a bit? Do people have questions?
We're actually sisters and we grew up in a nut household and I think it actually benefited us greatly because it means that we check our food and I think kids that are raised in households that don't have their allergen in it, they actually are more vulnerable. They don't think about what they're eating and eventually I think you're just putting yourself at risk. And
OK, so you're vigilant about this.
Yeah.
Because you grew up in that house. Yeah. Anyone else got questions at this point?
We choose in our household to live completely allergen-free, so we are free from eggs and nuts inside the house, only because we've got such small children. So it's the one place that they can be safe and not feel anxious.
Mm. Bibiana, I know you're one of Rob's patients. You have a son with 17 allergies,
yes.
Is that right? Food allergies?
Food allergies, and he is prompted to 5 of them there could be caused an anaphylactic attack. When Antonio was first diagnostic, he got 10, and as we go older, he keep increasing it. So he gets all his full arms full of allergies, he react to all of them. Only last year, finally, we go to a level that we go, okay, we're not getting more, that's good.
Mm. Were you worried about your second child there?
Yes,
in the photo?
Erica, when we decided to have Erica, we asked actually the RPA because it was really tough with Antonio. We went for that whole 6 months with no sleeping, a baby that was upset, cranky, crying. No one could settle him. So when you're thinking, I'm going to get this risk again, you need a bite. So we asked Dr. Lovely what we can do, and the advice was reduce the amount on us. With Antonio, I did have the craving of eggs. I eat eggs like going out of fashion. Antonio, one of the biggest allergies is eggs.
Uh-huh. Erica, your daughter? Yeah.
Yeah. Erica does not have allergies. We're testing her three times. All three times it came clear. But Erica does have intolerance. So fruits and vegetables are something that Erica only tolerate in little amounts.
Yeah. Well, so what have you learned from that experience with your two children, do you think?
Well, for us, be careful of what I eat during my pregnancy did make a substantial change. One of the advices was to be conscious about what I eat.
Hard to get to the bottom of this, though, isn't it, Katie? Look, just what, you know, it might be what you eat in pregnancy, but it might be something else altogether.
No, it's not going to be that. People get so excited about all this allergen exposure, but it's impossible to get everything out of your diet because we all have to eat. So I think that there's a lot of focus on how to get things in and out of your diet, but it makes it very complicated for families. They're very confused as a result.
Peter, we hear a lot about hygiene and about how we're too clean and too careful and we're not exposed to enough. I mean, do you believe that's the case? And what sort of research are you doing?
The notion that hygiene might be important came from studies that showed that kids who had more siblings were less likely to develop allergic diseases, and then a series of studies that showed that kids from farming environments seem to be at substantially reduced risk, in particular studies in Bavaria where you've got our pregnant women and children looking after the cows during winter that are almost sort of co-housed, they're in stables that are connected to the family house, and these are very healthy kids.
So we just need to all live with cows?
That's the moral of the story. I think so. I'm married to a dairy farmer's daughter, though. There's a range of other factors that have been associated with reduced risks, like pet ownership.
But people are allergic to pets too. Yeah, you know, how do you make that
difficult
work?
None of it's easy. All of this might be acting via influences on the composition of the gut flora in either the mother during pregnancy or the baby during early life or both.
So what are you doing? What research? You're collecting people's poo, I understand. Is that your research? Lots of it.
Not just me.
Yeah.
we have a big team of poo collectors.
What are you doing? What are you trying to find out?
So we've recruited over 1,000 pregnant women from the two hospitals where almost all the babies in the region are born over a three-year period. And we've collected poo samples from the mothers during pregnancy and the babies at birth, 1, 6, 12 months, and planning to repeat that at 2, 3 years and beyond.
And what are you finding?
I think it's sort of too early for us to really talk about what we are finding. What we are looking at is the composition of the mother and the baby's gut flora, and we're really trying to test some of the ideas that have been quite nicely drawn out in animal models that suggest particular types of organisms during early life might play a key role in stimulating the immune system to go down a sort of healthy pathway. And over the next 6 to 12 months, we'll be cracking open the freezers and and taking our poo samples out and extracting DNA and sending it off to collaborators in America and in Adelaide and trying to get robust answers to these questions.
Rob, what did you want to say?
Yeah, look, I think there's an important point to make about the types of allergies that are becoming more prevalent. Because egg and milk allergy has always been there. The big thing that's changed is peanut and the other nuts. And it began about 20 years ago. First a trickle, then a little more, then a flood. And that happened about 15 years ago.
Why? Why is that happening?
If this was simply lifestyle or hygiene or stress, it should affect all those allergies pretty much the same way. The thing that's changed is the nuts. And what seems to have been happening is for some reason, people are being exposed in a different way or to larger amounts of nuts, initially peanut and now other nuts, than they used to be before. So we've got an epidemic of nut allergies that wasn't there before.
And that's because we're eating them all, you think?
Well, nobody knows. Nobody knows why. But there's got to be something different. I mean, if you look at the admission statistics for anaphylaxis in hospitals, in the young age group, it shot up like exponentially, and most of it is nut anaphylaxis.
And that's where you get the really severe reactions too, isn't it, often? Yeah. Katie?
Rob's not quite right. In fact, in our health nut study, egg allergy was 9% of the general community was expressing some sort of egg allergy. But we know that half of those have already outgrown their egg allergy by 2 to 3 years of age. So what we do know is that peanut allergy and tree nut allergy are more likely to be lifelong, and therefore they look like they're more prevalent as well.
Mm. Phoenix, you're 9, is that right?
Yes.
And tell me what your favourite things are to eat.
Ice cream, cake, chocolate.
And Saxon, you're Phoenix's twin brother, but you can't eat all the same stuff as him. Can you tell me why you can't eat the same stuff?
Because I have some allergies which stop me from eating some foods.
Okay, so what are you allergic to? What kind of things can't you eat?
I can't really eat eggs, peanuts. I can't really have mandarin, oranges, bananas, grapes, watermelon.
What about strawberries? Can you eat strawberries?
No, I can't have those either.
Okay. Anything else?
I think that's it.
Yeah, that's a lot though, yeah? And what's that like for you, not to be able to eat those things?
It doesn't really bother me that much. I don't really notice it.
What about when he's eating them?
I don't really care.
Do you ever find yourselves fighting about it?
Well, he sometimes tells me not to eat it in front of him. That's about it.
That might be fair enough, actually, if he's really feeling like he wants to eat it, don't you think?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Karen, the boys are fraternal twins. So I just wondered whether you exposed them to different foods when they were babies.
No, they're exactly the same. They were breastfed till they were 8 months old and introduced solids at 6 months, and it was all organic vegetables.
Do you have any allergy, any allergic history?
Not to food, no.
To anything else?
Just hay fever, but that's about it. But Saxon is anaphylactic to egg whites and nuts, peanuts.
What happens if you have those things, Saxon?
I've had peanuts once.
What happened?
It made me cough really loud. And my throat was like all jammed a little bit. Mm.
And their dad, does he have any allergies?
He's allergic to bees, but no food allergies at all.
Katie, how much is environmental and how much is genetic? Well, you know, how much is what you eat and how much is this in your genes, no matter what?
Well, I mean, the big question of family history is an interesting one for food allergy, because certainly with asthma and allergic rhinitis, and which is hay fever and eczema, their genes seem to be incredibly important. And so allergists always say if you have one person with a family history, then you've got a 40% chance you've got allergy. If you've got two people with a family history, then you've got an 80% chance you're going to have some sort of allergy. But the same doesn't seem to be true for food allergy. But we think the increased risk is actually across both those with a family history and those without. And that's what makes us think that actually the environment may be something that's more important for food allergy than it is for the other allergic diseases.
Are you talking about giving them things you know they have a reaction to, but it's a mild reaction?
Yes.
Patrick, I have to tell you that our medical people here are looking very worried by your little experiment. Patrick Au in Melbourne, you have 5 kids. The 2 youngest have allergies. Tell us what they react to.
The firstborn in Australia has severe allergies to peanuts, allnuts, milk, eggs and shellfish. And the secondborn in Australia has a very, very minor reaction to peanuts, milk and shellfish and eggs.
What about the other three who were born overseas?
The other three older ones were born in Malaysia and they do not have allergies at all. And we are the first in our own respective families to have allergies.
Okay, what do you make of that?
Well, what we think was that it could be the hygiene. We could also think about the environment.
Hmm. Katie, what does Patrick's story tell us about what's going on?
Well, it does get us back to this concept of, you know, the migration effect. In our study, we found that Asian parents have a much lower rate of allergy themselves than Australian parents, but children who are born from Asian parents in Australia are three times more likely to have food allergy. And the effect particularly is for those who've come from a developing country as opposed to those who've migrated from places like Europe. So we think there's something in a developing country that's a protective factor.
What does your family back in Malaysia think about this, about the two children having allergies who were born here?
Really weird, because none of us have it. And when we told our families about it, they were very surprised and very shocked about this whole food allergies. I'm not sure whether they understand the seriousness of allergies as it's in Melbourne or in Australia, because it's something very foreign to them.
Bibiana, you've got your hand up. You're from Colombia.
Yeah, I'm from Colombia, and we're coming from a background where we don't have allergies either. We are fussy eaters. There's no in the culture. So my parents come and visit us, and they go, OK, we're not having eggs, we don't have nuts, we don't have... Oh, so we can... No, rice milk. That's what you have. You cannot have eggs.
When did you come here?
When I was 21.
All right. So your children were born here?
Yes. But it's, I also, and I guess you've found the same, it's a very isolating to have a child with allergies. Your friends, that you thought they were your friends for a long time, have difficulties to understand that their now life has changed. So you experience that a lot of people stop inviting you to teens, to invite you to parties. They're scared of cooking something that might affect Antonio.
Well, given the prevalence of potentially life-threatening allergies in children generally in Australia, let's have a look at how one school is handling it.
We have students from Year 6 that collect our first aid boxes. We have two first aid boxes that will go out onto every playground.
Okay, darling, what have you got? Playground 2?
Our first aid officer in the office will place the EpiPens into those boxes according to the playground rosters.
Thanks, boys.
The first aid boxes are very fluorescent orange boxes that can't be missed. Our first reminder is about remembering not to share food. We only eat the food that our parents have sent for us to eat, or that our parents have ordered via the touch shop.
When I go to buy anything new, I always investigate thoroughly. So, for example, our popcorn doesn't actually come with any list of ingredients. So I rang the company and they have sent me a list of ingredients, which we've put up there for display.
We do have a process of identifying students within our school that have food allergies. Those children would wear a yellow badge on the collar of their uniform. We can never guarantee that our school is 100% nut-free. We endeavour to minimise that risk at all costs.
Lee, why make the school nut-free? Why have you taken it that far?
We have a number of students at our school that have an allergy to nuts, some mild, some moderate, and some obviously that have anaphylaxis. So it's just one of our strategies. We constantly educate our students, as well as our parents, as well as our staff, in ensuring that they have a really solid understanding of what it is.
Have you had incidents at the school?
Touch wood. No, we haven't in the time that I've been there, but even prior to me being at the school, no, we haven't.
Katie, what do you think about the idea of nut-free schools?
Look, it's a very vexed question and every school seems to interpret it slightly differently. Even though allergen minimisation is recommended, it's not recommended to necessarily ban certain foods. And that's partly because you know, there are so many foods children are allergic to, and you can't ban all foods. And secondly, if a child leaves a school and goes down to the local cafe, you know, if they're not aware that they shouldn't be eating foods that they don't know the content of, and they're not sure of what they're eating, then they may take unnecessary risks. So it may give a false sense of security.
Karen, what do you think about the idea of nut-free schools?
My boys don't go to a nut-free school, but I'm okay with that. I have full faith in them. They recognise which children are anaphylactic and they advise the teachers. I think it's different when they're really young. I'd prefer those places to be like nut-free because it can potentially kill a child.
Mm. Kristen, what about you? Your kids are going to school soon, yeah?
Yeah. At the moment, they're at a daycare centre that is nut and egg free, as much as it can be, which is amazing for us. Two of our children have anaphylaxis. The school we're sending them to is not completely nut free, but they've got to grow up and potentially live with this for the rest of their life. So we don't want to shelter them.
And how severe are their reactions to those things? And have you had something that you thought was really life-threatening?
Yes. Our little girl, who was 18 months old at the time, had hazelnut chocolate and had anaphylaxis. And then 6 weeks later, I was making a nut-free cake, which, you know, Mother of the Year, I thought I was doing a wonderful job. And I gave my son a spatula to lick. And he, who had eggs every day of his life, had an anaphylactic reaction to the raw egg in the cake mix.
We've got a picture of him there.
Yeah, and that was taken.
Look at him.
A good couple of hours after his reaction.
Gosh, poor little thing. So now, what do you do in the house? Do you keep those things out altogether,
We do at the moment. It's the one place that, we don't feel stressed and anxious, and the kids can relax. And you know, I like to give my kids a kiss goodnight, and if I've eaten something, I feel like I can't. So
yeah, without
now, what's
your teeth?
Sorry, go on.
If we go like to parties and whatever, and people will say, "What can't we have?" and if I know that they do have peanut butter a lot, I'll just say, you know, would you mind, you know, if you get your kids to brush your teeth prior? Yeah. And it's the same, like if you had peanut butter, you'd have to.
Or a glass of wine. Or, you know.
Brush your teeth, wash your hands before you can
embrace
your child.
How do people react to this sort of stuff? Like,
I think they think you're a little bit crazy sometimes. But it comes to life or death of your children, so you don't, you know, you learn to live with. People either accept it or they don't. And, you know, that's just how it is. Yeah. And sometimes it takes for them to see a reaction, sadly enough, for them to realise
how serious it is.
I think they sometimes think we're making it up almost to that point.
Yeah.
Chris and I was in hospital and I was feeding the kids by myself. Two tins of spaghetti, identical. One big tin, one little tin. One's made in Australia, one's made in New Zealand. The little one, I thought, oh, this would be great. Packet daycare full of egg, identical labels, something simple as that. And you know, I'm meant to be on top of it. So for other people who know zero about it, it just must be completely overwhelming because I'm overwhelmed at times about it. You know.
Karina, let's have a look at your situation at home with your son, Anatoly.
Okay. I am 7. Oh, yeah. I'm allergic to dairy, eggs, cheese and nuts.
Sesame and, of course, to dust.
Did I say dairy?
All right, so you grab the bananas. The whole environment at home is basically for him, suited to his needs, to his allergies.
Now we have meat.
Ice cream! Look at that.
Now,
how good is that? We found lots of substitutes and so our whole diet has changed as a family.
I have eaten something like this has cheese in it. 1, 2, 3. But as soon as I eat it, it gets like itchy in my throat. I almost can't breathe a little bit.
So he's got his nasal sprays and the steroid one and then the EpiPen.
I have to take the bloody EpiPen. You have to go like Ching. Four, one, two, three.
So you take the safety cap off and you hold it, your thumb around, and then the needle comes out here.
8, 9, 10. Tissue, wipe, the blood off.
It's quite a live wire, your Anatoly, isn't he? He obviously knows the drill too, doesn't
Absolutely.
He?
Absolutely.
How far have you gone, though, to protect him?
I guess I didn't want to, like, overprotect him, but when he was diagnosed at 6 months, he was allergic and anaphylactic to so many food products. Like, I was left wondering, what can he eat? And so to create a safe haven at home, we had to eliminate a lot of foods so that at least at home he would have that place where he's you know, he doesn't get anaphylaxis.
Now, you've stopped work, is that right?
I guess I've had to. I just was called to the school so many times. My son is very, as you could tell, he's very vivacious. He's alert, he's aware. But in a way, it's also an anxiety because he could see that he was different from the other kids, and other parents don't always understand and they think you're overreacting. And I guess he did stop breathing at once when he was 1 year old. So it does make you just a lot more anxious.
So are you anxious as well, do you think?
I think so. Okay, you know, my son needs protection. I mean, he needs the education at the moment while he's young.
Is he still at school?
No.
So you're homeschooling him?
Yes. We're not homeschooling him to isolate him from it. It's just because his anxieties were so much, it was affecting his behaviour, and we thought that it was behavioural.
Olivia, how much of this do you see? You're a psychologist and you're interested in this area.
Yeah.
How much do you see anxiety coming with this issue of allergies?
Look, anxiety goes hand in hand with allergies, and I kind of think anxiety is really sort of anticipatory stress, if you like the brain sort of flipping forward in time to a what if. What if this happens? What if that happens? As soon as, you know, you kind of go to imagine, what if this thing happened? What if I ate this and I had an allergic reaction? Physiologically, the same response will kind of kick in.
And what about separating what's the child's anxiety and what is the parent's anxiety?
Yeah, it's a really difficult area because we're designed to be emotionally enmeshed with our kids. Both need to be handled, and actually sort of separating out, working with the child and the parent to as much as possible try and get them to own what is theirs. You'll say to a young person, particularly for a young child, if you're feeling sort of scared, is that yours or mum's? And often they'll say mum's. So, okay, so if you're feeling scared, is that yours or mum's? And eventually they'll go, mine. So, okay, so who's the only person in this whole, you know, universe who can actually change that? Me. It's important to note as well that we all have certain levels of anxiety and it is functional. So if I saw a child who had allergies and they didn't have a certain level of anxiety around it, I'd be concerned.
You'd be worried, yeah.
Yeah, that they weren't actually, like, able to put things into place or to think ahead of what do I need to do to kind of minimise my risk there. So it's on a sliding scale, but then if they're kind of, it turns into dysfunctional anxiety. So some extreme cases where, you know, that really by the time I see them, they're actually only, they're only eating two foods and drinking water. Mm.
Richard, tell us about food challenges. How do food challenges work and what are they for?
Can I also mention a little bit about anxiety as well? I'm not sure whether it may reassure people, but if you look at fatalities, which is the worst outcome, I'm not aware of any deaths from peanut allergy under the age of 5 years anywhere in the world. Okay, no deaths under the age
five.
Of five.
Mm. Okay, and yet so that's where people worry the most.
Exactly. Mm. And also, perhaps to reassure people as well, from touching, from coughing, getting life-threatening anaphylaxis is really, really rare. You've got to eat the food. So if the fear is that somebody can cough on your child after eating peanut and your child can die from it, then I would say that the risk is higher from being struck by lightning than it is from that event. Mm. The concept of food challenges, we do it for various things, sometimes for various reasons. Some children would be tested, either skin or blood test, and it's positive, but they've actually never had a history of ever reacting to the food. And many of my patients know that I skin test positive to rice, and my blood test is positive to rice. I rice almost every day. So that term we use is sensitized, but not necessarily clinically allergic. Mm-hmm. So we often then introduce foods in a hospital environment. So we assess risk, and in most cases, you find that the child actually isn't allergic, but has allergy antibodies and sensitized. Mm.
Erica, you're 20, you're allergic to nuts, and you had a food challenge when you were younger. How did it go?
It turned out really horribly. So I've always had an allergy to nuts, but when I went through puberty, the skin test was inconclusive. So I went in for the nut challenge, and so they gave me increments of peanut butter over time, and I didn't have any reaction whatsoever, and everyone was getting really excited. And then I had the half tablespoon, and then after another hour, they gave me another half tablespoon, and within 45 seconds, I couldn't breathe. They had to call a respiratory arrest code in the hospital. They gave me 7 or like more adrenaline shots. They almost had to intubate me. It was very terrifying.
Very terrifying. Mm. Yeah. How long ago was this?
It was first term into year 7. And then since then, I've never looked at nuts again.
Yeah. Hannah, how did it affect you, seeing your sister like that?
Yeah, well, obviously it was pretty scary. So I was only 8 at the time, and I wasn't at the hospital when she had the challenge. I was with my mum and my other sister, who doesn't have any allergies.
Do you have any?
Yeah, I'm allergic to nuts as well. Mm. Yeah, I don't go anywhere near nuts.
Like, you still haven't had a reaction though. You've never actually had a...
No, I've never had a reaction. I just got retested, and they want me to do the almond challenge, in the hospital, which obviously I don't really want to do, considering what happened to Erica.
Erica, how much has it changed your behaviour now, like in terms of what you do? Your boyfriend Joshua's here. I mean, how does it affect both of you, for example?
So before he ate a sandwich, and I won't let him kiss me because I'm not confident that it doesn't have anything in it. But he also, on grand final day, he bought footy mix, just like picked off the shelf and just came back with it, and it had nuts in it, and I was like, oh, I can't eat it. And then he was just eating it, and I kind of was just like sitting on the other side of the room, and he had to go wash his hands and brush his teeth before he come near me again.
Tricky, huh?
Yeah.
Patrick, you want to say something. What did you want to say?
Yes, I was. Basically, I've got a household of 5 kids, and I'm very mindful that we have to make sure that the Esther and Ben is not excluded from family activities. So our house is not peanut free. So what we try to do is to challenge Esther and Ben to try different food, bits and pieces of it, and to help them try them and see how the reaction would be.
Can I just ask you then, are you talking about giving them things you know they have a reaction to, but it's a mild reaction? Or are you talking...
Yes. Yes, so what we try to do is give them small quantities of hard-boiled and soft-boiled eggs, just for them to taste it, and we will always watch for the reactions because they may be able to eat it. So we don't know until we kind of push the boundaries and encourage them to eat the food.
Patrick, I have to tell you that our medical people here are looking very worried by your little experiment. I want to know why. What do you think about what Patrick's doing?
You can't guarantee if a child had mild moderate reactions that the next reaction will be mild moderate. It could be severe. Every child's an individual. I would caution these challenges at home.
Okay, Katie, what do you think?
Yeah, so I think the community is getting this sort of idea that, oh, we should just desensitise at home. Mm-hmm. And we don't believe that's a good thing because they may have a nasty reaction.
Okay. Patrick, your reaction to hearing that it's risky,
what you're
doing?
Well, we just have to be careful. It is risky, but we have to try to see what else they can eat and extent that they can eat.
Okay, Robert?
Yeah, look, with egg, it's a different story. Once they tolerate baked egg in small amounts, they can experiment a little bit at home. It's an entirely different story with nuts. Never, never do this at home with nuts.
Yes.
Mm. Yep. Do you do it with nuts, Patrick?
No.
Mm, okay. Sam, I know that last week your 4-year-old did a food challenge for almonds. How did he go?
he seems to have passed, which is good. So that was his third food challenge. He'd previously passed hazelnut a couple of years ago. So we have Nutella Day on Saturday where he gets to eat Nutella, and that's how we keep up his exposure every week.
So you've got to keep the exposure going once you've had a success.
Then a year ago he did a baked egg challenge and he failed. And he'd previously at 18 months had anaphylaxis from eating cake crumbs off the floor at playgroup.
Okay, so this is really touch and go, isn't it?
Well, I think yes and no. I think we have to be careful about people's opinions and, again, what we do know. We do know how to diagnose and how to manage food allergies. There's absolutely no question about that. What we don't know is the severity. So we can't predict mild, moderate and severe.
We're really excited. We're working on a new so-called spire therapy, which is a new class of treatment. It's not all gloom and doom. I think it really is sort of a good news story in some ways.
Anne-Marie, we've talked a lot about pregnant women and babies tonight, but what's it like for you developing an allergy now? At this stage?
When I first developed my goat's cheese allergy, I was not serious about it. I knew how ill I was that night, but when the next few days went on, I thought, oh, that was pretty dangerous. But as time's gone on, I've read more about it, I've become far more vigilant about how I'm managing it.
Scott, you've had a different experience to that.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I was always taught not to eat nuts, and when I'm 27 now, and through the years I've had sort of various reactions, pretty mild, like an itchy throat, swollen tongue or whatever, but about 2 weeks ago I had quite a life-threatening reaction. I ended up in resuscitation at St Vincent's Hospital. Me and my girlfriend just had ice cream at an ice cream shop, and it was just from a contaminated scoop. Like, I had to use the EpiPen, and I honestly thought I was going to die.
That must have been terrifying.
Oh, it was, yeah. It's so scary. Like, I've never had a heart attack, but it felt like that was what was happening. And my throat was so swollen, I was trying to vomit, but I couldn't vomit. And, like, I felt like it was like I had gastro, like, from both ends, but I couldn't control it. And, I was nearly blacking out, and my girlfriend Casey stabbed me with the EpiPen.
Okay. Katie, how do you explain that?
Yeah, I mean, it is completely the unpredictability of the condition. We really don't know the answer to that. And that's what makes people so worried about having this food allergy, is you don't know if you're going to have a mild reaction or a severe reaction. And that's why we give the same recommendation. If you've had a mild reaction, avoid the food. We just know you should avoid the food.
Robin, tell us a little bit about the work that you're doing and the research you're doing to try and find a treatment for peanut allergy.
Okay, well, we're really excited. We're working on a new so-called spire therapy, which is a new class of treatment. And what this involves is we've identified the critical fragments of the major peanut allergens, which can be administered into non-inflamed skin to induce clinical and immunological tolerance. And the fragments themselves are short and they don't bind the allergy antibodies, so they're not able to induce anaphylaxis. Now, this is still evolving, but we're particularly excited about this approach because spire therapy for house dust mite, cat allergy and grass pollen allergy has just gone through very successfully clinical trials in Canada, and it's using the same approach and using some of our early research in those allergens.
Are we going to find a cure for all of this? What do you think?
I think that the spire therapy is the most exciting. It's not all gloom and doom. I think it really is sort of a good news story in some ways.
Maria, you want a government, a national strategy on this.
Yes, we do. We want best care, optimal care for anyone with allergic disease anywhere in Australia. And currently there are different things being done well in some areas, but there is a lot that is not being done well. People should not have to wait 18 months to see an allergy specialist. Precautionary labelling is a huge issue, and food choices have decreased for people with food allergy. The food service industry is a huge, you know, people have wonderful experiences, but then we hear horrific stories.
What about the cost of all of this? I mean, how much is covered by the PBS, and how much does it cost to how much do EpiPens cost?
EpiPens and AnaPens now can be prescribed on the PBS. So people who fit the criteria can have two devices prescribed, and it will cost them $36 for the two devices. However, you know, people with food allergy or insect allergy often have asthma, eczema, allergic rhinitis, and much of the medication is not subsidised.
Kristen?
At any given, like, we've got 8 EpiPens on script at all times. You know, 2 for daycare for each child, 2 in each child's
pack.
How
much are they each?
Well, we're entitled to 2 for $36, but then the other 6 is $120 a pop, which will last 12 months.
At the other end of this, is there any evidence that EpiPens are being overprescribed to people? Katie?
I mean, that's a very good question to ask. There has been a publication showing that there's been a major increase in the prescription of EpiPens, and some people have argued maybe there's an overprescription of EpiPens, but we're missing one very important piece of data, in my opinion, and that is how many of these EpiPens are being fired off. If the rates of anaphylaxis or the rates of death are low, and it's because people are firing off the EpiPens, then that's good. But if they've got an EpiPen and then no one's actually using them, either because they don't know how to use them or when to use them, then there's no point, one, prescribing them, and there may be an overprescription of EpiPens.
Richard, will we solve the problem of, or the riddle, I suppose, of food allergy anytime soon?
5 years ago, I told patients 3 to 5 years, and now we're here. I don't think that we're going to find a cure for food allergies, but there is hope in terms of desensitising, either by injections or orally or drops under the tongue.
OK. Robert, do you think we'll have a major breakthrough anytime soon in this area?
I'm not expecting anything dramatic. I'm fairly optimistic that we'll learn how to pick people who are at highest risk in the future, maybe by genetic screening.
Maria?
I've been told that, you know, we have a cure three years down the track since 1990. There's a lot of great research that's happening, but I think we need to put as much emphasis on the fact that food allergy is manageable if you're educated.
Katie, what do you think? How optimistic are you?
Look, I'm extremely optimistic because this is a new problem. And so there must be something that we're doing differently. It's got to be something that we can turn around. And if we can do that, then I think there's a good chance that we'll prevent some, if not all, food allergies in the future. That's my great hope anyway.
OK, we do have to leave it there. Thank you all very much for joining us tonight. And that is all we have time for here. But let's keep talking on Twitter and Facebook. We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone.